did get his prayer answered. He got to see the glory. It just took him about 1,500 years to get there. But 2 Corinthians chapter 4 tells us that we see the glory of God in the face of Jesus. And up on the Mount of Transfiguration, the Bible said that Jesus was there, and Moses and Elijah was having a conversation with him. And so there is a difference in Jesus and Adam. The Bible said that Adam was made in the image of God. The Scripture said that Jesus is the image of God. And it's one thing to be made in his image, but when you are the image, when you're the full expression of who he is. It took Moses 1,500 years to get there, but he got to see the Lord face to face. Amen. But when God showed up, he said, "I'm going to cause all my goodness to pass before you." Whenever you're in the presence of God, you're in the presence of ultimate goodness. Now, life ain't always good, but God's always good. The devil ain't ever good, but God's always good. Amen. Your history may not be good, but with Jesus, your present and your future is good. Well, Luke chapter 15. Check. I did. The light was on, and it's there. So maybe I need to slide it up a little further. I'll just, all right. Well, praise the Lord. Maybe I just eat it. If I swallow it. I've had a scope before. I don't want one of them. Praise the Lord.
Yes, he did not lie from the pulpit.
Hallelujah. Not this time. Now, when it comes to time, you know what the Bible said? A day with the Lord has 1,000 years. My preaching has some similarities to that. Luke chapter 15. This is just right hot off the press. Just while I was sitting there, and this is the scripture the Lord instructed me to go to, and so this is where we're going to go. In Luke 15. And, Lord, it's verse 11. He said, "And a certain man had two sons, and the younger of them said to his father, 'Father, give me the portion of goods that falls to me.' And he divided unto them his living. And not many days after, the young son gathered all together and took his journey into a far country. And there he wasted his substance with riotous living. And when he had spent everything, there arose a mighty famine in that land, and he began to be in want. And he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent him into his fields to feed the swine. And he would have filled his belly with the husk that the swine did eat, and no man gave unto him. And when he came to himself, he said, 'How many hired servants of my father's have bread enough and to spare? And yet I perish with hunger. I will arise and go to my father, and will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you, and I am no more worthy to be called your son. Make me as one of your hired servants.' And he arose and came to his father, but when he was yet a great way off, his father saw him," I love this, "and had compassion, and ran and fell on his neck, and he kissed him. And the son said unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in your sight, and I'm no more worthy to be called your son. But the father said to his servants," now notice that, the son was saying to the father didn't even address what he said, not with words. "But the father said to his servants, bring forth the best robe and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand and shoes on his feet, and bring hither the fatted calf and kill it, and let us eat and be merry. For this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. And they began to be merry." Now, I won't go into everything that the older son and the father got into a conversation about. But I love what he said in verse 29. He said, he answered the father, "These many years I've served you, have never transgressed at any time your commandment, and you never gave me a kid that I might make merry with my friends. But as soon as this son was come, which has devoured your living with harlots, you have killed for him the fatted calf. And he said unto him, Son, you are forever with me, and everything that I have is yours. But it was meet that we should make merry and be glad. For your brother was dead and is alive again." Yeah. You got to forgive me because I'm not over this yet. He said he was lost and is found. He was, but he is.
not just talking about physical sickness, even though we know that Jesus took stripes on his back for our healing. And he wasn't just talking about emotional healing and mental healing. He was talking about physical body healing. Because in Isaiah 53, when he said, it was one of the most beautiful pictures of the crucifixion of Jesus. And he says to us that he was wounded for our transgressions, and he was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement needed to obtain my peace and my well-being was upon him, and with his stripes we were healed.
Yeah.
Now over in Matthew 8:17, it was five different times Jesus healed someone of a physical illness, and it said that it might be fulfilled which was prophesied by Isaiah. Surely he has borne my sicknesses and carried away my diseases. And so that scripture wasn't just talking about spiritual healing. It was talking about physical healing. Amen.
Yeah.
Because healing's not confined to a specific time or place. Before there was ever a disease to be healed, the nature of God was healing. Because in Exodus 15, God said this, I am the God that heals you. So healing's not just something that God does. Healing is something that God is. The reason there's no sickness is in heaven because his light penetrates every place and there's no darkness there. His presence is there in the fullness of its glory. And so there's no disease can exist in the presence of God. Amen. And so it's not just, it's not one or it's all of it. He's a healing God.
Yeah.
But sin is the most broken condition. It's the most sick and diseased condition that you and I can be in, because it is the door opener for every other thing that you and I would ever face. What you find in the garden is absolute perfection. It's the perfection of healing and wholeness. There's no pain there, no disease there, no heartache there, there's no evil there, there's no destruction there, there's no war there, there's no famine there, there's no depression there, there's no oppression there, there's just man with God. Most folk wouldn't know how to pray if they didn't have a problem. But Adam prayed every day. Adam walked with the Lord in the Bible called it the cool of the day. It was that word cool was the spirit, the breath. It was a Hebrew word ruach. In other words, it was in the spirit of the day. What it meant was after the labor was over, that the voice of the Lord would come and God would speak to man. What he's talking about is just a time of rest. Every day was the same. Because in that garden, even labor, there was no toil, there was no weariness, there was no tiredness. Because it was perfection. Sin was gone. What sin did was it opened the world to the worst depravities of humankind.
Yeah.
And I don't care what nation you go into, you find the evidence of sin. Every one of us, some of us, many of us even bear physical scars that came from the depravity of sin. Sin takes us to the very lowest place. When the scripture said, all have sinned and come short of the glory, he was really just saying that everyone has sinned. And when we sin, we fall short of Jesus, who is the glory of God revealed. And so what sin does is it opened the planet to the most painful, most broken, most darkened condition. The church wants to play with sin almost like it's a pet. We ought to just wink at it. God's not winking at it. It cost his son his life.
Right.
The crucifixion is the picture of how evil and wicked and how awful that sin is. Sin's not something that God just might let place their heart to look at what he knows they are. No. Sin. He knows what it's done to us. And if we look around, you see. If you look in here, you know that even when it's not your own sin, the sin that others have committed puts on sin every day. You can sing him. That's people I used to drink with.
Yeah.
I hated drinking with people like this. There's some folk
when they get drunk, they want to talk about Jesus coming. I don't know why drunks want to get into Revelation. Why they want to talk about Jesus coming back, why they want to sing Amazing Grace. I couldn't stand people like that.
If they, one time, I ain't drinking with you no more. Because I don't want to think about Jesus coming back when I got a belly full of something other than chicken.
It takes them 30 minutes to get you sung into a place of being happy. Well, I better preach.
That's an old proverb saying, where the tree falls, that's where it lays. You know, I was listening to a 30 volume down. You're going deaf if you're out here. Anyway, so the scripture tells us this amazing story about a young man.
There was in chapter 19, in the first couple of verses, the Bible talked about how that Jesus had went and had left Galilee, went down into Judea and out down into that region. The Bible said that they followed him, and there he healed them.
Yeah.
And there he healed them. Where did he heal them? The place that they followed. Because it's only once we surrender our life to Jesus and follow him that you'll find the ultimate place of your healing. And it has to begin with the sin issue, because you'll never be able to fully experience the healing touch of Jesus for your whole man until you get the sin dealt with.
That's
because
right.
Sin opens up everything.
Yeah.
It opens up everything. And so we need that part to be dealt with. And so what we see is a man, Jesus telling the story about a man that had two sons. And the younger son, he said, I want you to give me what belongs to me before you die. I want my inheritance now. I don't want to wait. And so the scripture said that he took it. While he was in Dad's house, he had everything he could ever imagine. I mean, Dad had enough money to give him something. Amen. Most of us never raised in an environment where father and mother had enough to leave us for an inheritance.
Yeah.
Why people fight over it.
Absolutely.
You can't divide a TV up into fours. If you fight over it, quit. That's why people fight over it. No, this man had more than enough. And the young man said, I'm ready. I'm ready to take what you got, but I want what you have without you. And see, sin will do that. We want the blessing that comes from God, but we don't want him.
Right.
And that's where we end up getting in trouble. Because the truth is even in a fallen state, God's blessed us. And then I'm going to tell you something. This nation is more blessed than what we have got our trouble, we got our issue, but I've been in enough places in the world to tell you, we're more blessed than what we realize.
Yeah,
I know we got our we got it. You got it everywhere in the world, but we're blessed people.
That's right.
And we're spoiled people.
Yeah,
and I pray to God that we never, ever have to experience what other folks are experiencing around the world.
Yeah.
But sometimes when we get spoiled, we want to enjoy what was
So Esau's supposed to step up. He don't, because he don't care about the spiritual condition of the family. All he cared about was the blessing. And so when he comes in, because all of a sudden a man who the Bible said was a cunning hunter, that means he's good at it.
Yeah.
I ain't blessed like that. You know what a hunt is for me? Fall asleep in tree stand. That's what I do. Yeah. Or wait, and then wake up and hear something moving. No, slept through another one. My fishing is but he was a cunning hunter, the Bible said. But all of a sudden it's not working for him. Because he comes home and he hadn't killed nothing. He's hungry. Because when you're supposed, when it's time for us to step in to the thing that God has really called us to do. God didn't call Esau to be a cunning hunter. God called Esau to be the man that steps up and takes his responsibility in the position of his father. But the Bible said he despised that responsibility. And when he was hungry, he told his brother, he said, well, yeah, you can have the responsibility, but I'm still the oldest. So he thought he still won't get the blessing. What he didn't realize is that the blessing always follows your spiritual life. That's why when Jesus came upon Simon Peter, who was a professional fisherman, and he said, follow me, and I'll make you fishers of men. Because you thought, Peter, you thought that you were created by God just to fish. But what you didn't know, what you never known was this. I've called you to take the gospel to the nations of the earth. I've called you to preach my word. I've called you to be an apostle of the church. And when Peter had denied the Lord three times in John 21, he said, I'm going back to fishing.
Yeah.
In other words, he's not saying fishing trip. He said, I'm going back to my old life, to doing what I used to do when Jesus called me. But the Bible says, Jesus came out on the shore and said to him, hey, have you caught any fish?
Yeah.
Well, I've been fishing all night. And I ain't caught anything. Now you know he's in trouble. He denied the Lord. He said, I'm going back to my old life. Jesus comes out there. He's not just fishing. The boy don't have no clothes on. Sit there and say, come on over here. And they sat down ready to eat, right in the same time. said, Lord, you know, he said, feed my sheep. In other words, get back to the thing I called you. The second time, Simon said, do you love me more than these fish? Do you love me more than your own life? Lord, you know, feed my lambs. In other words, go back to the thing I called you. The third time, how many times did Simon Peter deny him? Three times. How many times the Lord asked him, do you love me more than your own life? He said the third time, he got first three. He said, Lord, you know I love you. He said, then feed my sheep. In other words, do the thing I called you to do. You failed, yes, three times you failed. I knew you would fail. I told you that you would fail. You said, though everybody else forsake you, I won't do it. What I'm doing, Peter, is calling you back to the place that you ran away from. Do you love me more than your own life? No, Lord, I love you more than anything. Then get back to doing the thing that I called you to. Because the blessing on your life is found in the thing that I've created you for.
Yeah.
He took the blessing and he ran from the presence of the Father, thinking that the key to joy was just the blessing of life, but it's the presence of the Father that maintains the power of the blessing on your life. And so it even worked for a while. The Bible said he went out and he spent all he had. See, when he was at Dad's house, they were spending what they had.
Yeah.
And there was an endless supply of it. It's not for money.
Yeah.
You know about kids?
Oh, yeah.
You know, if there wasn't a lie, you almost want to tell them. But, you know, money does go through. But you just have to go up there and find it. Look at it. And it's not cheap stuff. These people get them all, you know, $2 things and all. So we went overseas to come back. Just eating the McDonald's stuff. I'm like, what kind of lifestyle is this plan on trying to live? Next time you see Mama, I bet he's got, you know, 5-10 carrots on each finger or something. He's a clown. I don't know why that takes the price of those shoes increase. You know, I don't know, but it, I mean, it's the way I five of us. And they don't stop eating. Ever. But they don't have to pay for a thing. You know what they get to enjoy? The fruit of everybody else's labor. But once you take that and you leave the presence of the Father, you leave access to the resources, and what you've got is what you can maintain for however long you can maintain. And the deception is that we look at what we've got left and we think it's all right, but we don't realize what sin has cost us. Because you may have the money, but it's costing you your morality. You may have the money, but it's costing you your dignity. You may have the money, but it's costing you your joy. You may have the money, but it's costing you your peace. You may have every other natural thing that God blessed you with, but the reality is that sin costs you. The wages of sin is death, and the gift of God is eternal life. That eternal life is a gift that never stops giving, but that sin is a sin that always takes. And listen, we're talking an eternity of taking. you've got such a generous father, and you're in the house with him, if you run out, he's got more than enough in the spare. But when you leave his presence, you just got what you've got. And we oftentimes don't realize that it's costing us until we get a time of famine.
Yeah.
And when the famine comes, famine does a whole lot of things. One thing that it ends up doing is producing a hunger. And my prayer tonight is that if you're here, you're lost without Jesus, that I've caught you in a famine moment, in a place where there's a hunger that's going on the inside
that's
of
right.
you. And you realize that what you're hungry for is not what's available to you right where you are, but there's something in the presence of God that will satisfy every longing that you've ever had, every hunger that you've ever wanted. Because no matter how blessed you are in the natural, without God's presence alive, real to you, without being able to know Him as Father, you are as bankrupt as anybody who's lost everything they have. I promise you, sin is costing you everything. And in the end, it will cost you everything.
Yeah, it will.
And so what the son found is he spent everything that he had. And it's amazing that when you leave the presence of the Father, there's always people who show up that are willing to help spend what you got. Legions are everywhere.
Yeah.
One of my other pet peeves in my drinking days. Don't sing about Jesus or talk about the end times. Number two, I'm broke. I just spent everything I had on what I got. Don't ask me for money, because I'm not giving you money for you to drink. Again, y'all act like you've never been there before. You got $5? Proverbs even said that a man that has riches has lots of riches.
Yeah.
He'll help you spend. In other words, there'll be people, the world is designed to bring people to surround you. You'll find that this relationship costs you something. This relationship costs you something. That relationship costs you something. This one took something out of it, because what we're talking is not money. What we're talking is parts of your heart, part of your life. And so I left the presence of God, made some really stupid decisions, had some people around my life, and it seemed like the more I'm with these people, the more it takes something out of me that it feels like I'll never be able to get back. This is how the world works. Because the thief and everybody under his influence is wired to take until you're just a shell of a man and a shell of a woman. But the Bible said that after he spent everything that he had on righteous living, the moment it had cost him everything, a famine hits. So on top of everything it costs him, the famine hits the land. And so you got to have, in a famine, it's not that there's not necessarily food. It's just that if there is food, it costs you so much that the people who take the worst hit are the poor.
Yeah.
Because only the wealthy were able to purchase the food to survive. And so those who were in the poorest condition often died of starvation in the time of famine. And so when the famine hits, he goes and works among slaves. This is not just a man that found a job that was no good. The Bible tells us that he was out there working in the fields with the rest of these hired servants. They're basically, it's slave labor is what it is.
Yeah.
And so you've got just enough. You know it's not taking care of the need, because the Bible said while he's out there in the fields, he was so hungry that he would have ate the husks that the pigs ate. So it's not enough money to be able to even supply enough food for your survival. I'm working and I'm making money, but I'm still starving. And I'm looking at anything. I'll devour anything when I'm hungry enough. When people get to that, when sin takes you to a certain place, it'll bring you to the lowest of the low. Well, you'll partake of things in your life that you never dreamed you would ever partake of. You'll do things you never dreamed you would do. You'll say things that you didn't dream you would say.
Yeah,
and when you find yourself in a place, God, how did I get here? Because I remember that 7-year-old boy that dreamed of things better than this. I remember the 10-year-old little kid that had dreams and had a vision, that looked at astronauts and thought, I'd like to be this. Or so and the tree fell on your head, God didn't tip that tree over on you. You were living in a place you never should have been at, because these trees ain't falling in the Father's house. The thief ain't coming into Daddy's house and making a mess out of everything. This man didn't get in that condition because the Father put him in the condition. That young man got in the condition that he did because he left the presence of the Father and went to live his own life. There is a way that seems right to a man, but the Bible said the end thereof is destruction. God didn't do that to you. The Father didn't do that to the Son. The Son's lifestyle, the moment you leave the Father's house, you come under the influence of the God of this world. The Bible calls him the devil. And he is a slave master. He don't know how to handle people of royalty. He knows how to make slaves out of everybody. That's why Goliath he'll use to work his work for him. But in the end, Goliath ends up with his head cut off and the fowl of the air devouring his life, because the devil will use you, he'll abuse you, and he'll discard you because he sees no value in you whatsoever. But the Father, he wasn't the one doing this to the Son. The Father was the one who was looking every day from afar off, waiting on my boy to come back from the dead. The Bible said this, that when the young man came to himself, because if you're going to come back to God, you're going to have to come to him. Because we're waiting on what we're looking for, and what the world's looking for, is for God who will come out and let us compromise. If Jesus didn't come just to forgive my sin and then keep me bound in it.
That's right.
But he'll take me as I am. Yes. But you won't leave him as you came. Because salvation isn't about me coming as a sinner and leaving under the weight of sin. It's about me coming as a sinner and being so transformed by the power of God that my life goes from a dead life to a resurrected life.
Thank you, Lord.
Yeah.
Christ transforms us.
Yeah.
Jesus wasn't just going to build you a mansion. Jesus was going to prepare a place for you in the presence of God. Because the Bible said that he went and offered himself to the Father, his own blood to the Father, as a forerunner to prepare a place for us in the presence of God. He wasn't just going to build you a mansion. He was going to prepare a place for you in the presence of God, so that where he is, so that where I am, you can be also. And here's the beauty. I don't have to wait to die to be here. Because the Bible tells us in Hebrews chapter 4 that Jesus went there first so that you and I could come boldly into the throne of grace, and that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in a time of need. And every time that I pray, I'm having access and audience with the Father. And so when he says, I'm going to arise and go into the presence of my Father, can I tell you that the reason why that we can is because Jesus did. This is resurrection talk.
Yeah.
He said, but I'm going to go there. He said, but I know I'm not worthy to be called a son. And I'm just going to tell him, I'll be one of your hired slaves. Just take me in as a servant, because I've dishonored you in the ultimate way. And I'm not worthy to be called your son anymore. So he gets up and he goes. And the Father sees it from afar off. And I love it. He said, when his Father saw him, he made a move in his direction. the Lord, but my place of healing is in following Jesus, and I'm going to follow where he went. Where did he go? Right into the presence of the Father. And if Jesus went there, that's where I want to be. And the place of my wholeness, my healing, my salvation, my deliverance, my forgiveness is right in the presence of the Father. So I'm going to get up and I'm going to make that decision today that I'm going to surrender my life to God, because even though I don't feel any value, I know he'll at least love me enough to make me one of his servants. But the moment he began to move in the direction of the Father, Dad saw him coming from afar off, and the Father took off running. And he didn't show up and say, "What have you been doing? How come you did this? How come you did that?" He embraced the Son and pulled him close to himself. The Bible tells us in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 that God was in Christ reconciling the world unto himself and not holding our sins and our trespasses against us. But boldly declare, "Come on in and be reconciled with your relationship." In Christ, and said to every one of us, and if you're lost here tonight, he's saying to you, you have a place in the Father's presence. He will not push you away. He embraced him and brought him close. He didn't shun him for a month. He didn't put him in time out. He held him. Ephesians 1:6 says, "I've been accepted." He accepted. Jail sentence pending. Stomach tore up. Bad shot. Laid in radiator recordings. Paper on my hands. Spit up blood for weeks. Nearly killed a mother. Or had been in a mental institution. Suicide. Well, because I was looking for attention, I was back inside. That's the reason why we're not seeing the world. And we can help. You sat down on the testimony to the room.
Yeah.
We love stories about the probable, but we don't like to talk about probably me. Because sometimes it gets a little too much. The last time I read, the Bible said that he was able to save to the uttermost those who call on God by name, because he ever lives to make intercession for us. That story shows me that no matter what kind of sin that you've been involved in, do you know that the honorable Apostle Paul, before they called him the saint, they made idols and images out of him, and before we've honored him the way that we have, he had no problem telling the church that he was the chiefest of sinners and he deserved mercy the least because he had persecuted the church of God. He had blasphemed the Holy Spirit, he said, "But I did it in ignorance and God had mercy on me." He had no problem telling them about where he came from because he needed them to know no matter what you've done, the Father is moving your direction. He loves you. Care if you put a needle in your arm on your way to church tonight. He loves you. He wants to save you. I don't care if you turn a trick before. Listen to me. He'll save you. He loves you. He said, "I'm not worthy." The Father didn't even address that statement. He looked at the servants. He said, "Go get the best robe and put it on him. Get some shoes on my boy's feet. Get a ring and put on his finger and kill that fatted calf, because my son that was dead is alive. He was lost and now he's found." My son.
Yeah.
He didn't just say it so the boy could hear it. He said it
wrap it up and say in this way.
I want you to go get that robe and put it on. I want you to put the shoes on. I want you to put a ring on. He sent you some amazing pictures.
That's right.
But let me just, for the sake of time, say this. I don't want my boy looking like that. I don't want him to smell. I want his testimony to be so good that when he starts to share it, people almost look at him like,
yeah.
Because Christians are not better than sinners. But don't you ever tell me we're not. Because I'm not the same as Dan. I'm not the same as me. Because if we're up to you, it's not that we're saying we're there. But don't tell me. Because I think there's a difference in being dead.
Amen.
I think there's a big difference in being lost.
Yeah.
Lost your keys. Big difference when you find them. You can use them. You don't just dream about how you used to be.
Right.
Dead and alive are different. Some of y'all ate chicken before you got here. If they get killed first, how their feathers taste for you, and how many times you get pet, but there is a difference in a live chicken and a dead one.
That's right.
I'd be happy if you all want to try this out after church. We'll see you try to eat one that's still clucking and flopping on your plate. There's a difference. Don't tell them that there's no difference. No, there is a difference. We're just not there. Because every one of us was dead. Every one of us was lost. And every one of us was sick and in need of a physician. Every one of us have been lumped into the same thing because Adam made sure in the fall. And the devil made sure when sin came in that we all got lumped. All have sinned. All. You know what that means? In the same as it does in good old English. All means all of us have sinned. All of us were lumped into this thing. What's the difference? Jesus. He's the difference.
Yeah.
And so what the Father said, and Jesus gave us a picture when he raised Lazarus from the dead. First thing he said, get the grave clothes off of him. Because you only wear those when you're dead. But he's not dead anymore. And I don't want him looking like that. I don't want him smelling like it. No evidence whatsoever. When the blood cleanses you, he removes the evidence of sin. I'm not talking about this. I'm talking about on the inside that he undressed that death garment that I wore and gave me a life-giving garment. That identifies me as a child of God. I don't deserve him, but he loves me.
Yeah.
Yeah. Jesus, what if y'all love me? Get me the Jew. You replace me. The Bible said that they follow him. And there, in the place they fall, he healed them. You know, the Bible tells us that in the presence of the angels, when one sinner comes home, there's rejoicing. But notice he didn't just say the angels were rejoicing. He said in the presence of the angels. Because you know who rejoices more than the angels do? Nobody's happier than the Father. Nobody. Psalm chapter 16, verse 10 through 12. There's a prophecy about the burial, the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. And he said, it was written, you're not going to suffer didn't say the Father looked on the Son with disgust. He said he looked on him with compassion. Because when he saw his boy, he knew his boy and what his boy could be. And he saw what sin did to him, and it broke his heart, and he had compassion on him. God's not here to hold your sin against you. God's here to just follow up on you and embrace you. And let his love pour into you and show you his compassion. And if you'll surrender your life to him and follow him there, the moment that you make that. Because he's seen what sin has done to you. He's here because he knows what it's cost you. Yes. Hosanna had a jail preaching. The Lord had told me on the way to the jail. He gave him the sword of Rahab. He said, I'm sending the priest to the women tonight. He said, there's a little Rahab that's there. I want you to tell her. He said, and she'll open her heart and surrender her life to me. That the death sentence that's on her life is on me. The bad that dwells in her. can't wait to see what comes out of this. A year later, I get a phone call on Wednesday night to prepare for church. She said, I know you're probably getting ready for church, but I had to tell you. Guess what I saw at the grocery store? And it hit me in my heart. I said, I don't know where. She said, I asked her how she was doing. She said, everything that God promised happened. She said, when I had the child, she said, it was a little boy. Well, you got a 50-50 chance to get that one right. She said, when they tested him to see if he had HIV, AIDS, clean bill of health. She said, they retested me. You've got to understand, she's dying. We're not talking about a misdiagnosis. She's been dying for months and months and months. They retested her. Absolutely gone. She said, I'm healthy. I'm healthier than I've ever been. This fella here is my husband. He don't care about my history. We fell in love. He's working a good job. I'm off drugs. My whole life's been turned around. Now, there's some folk who would say, well, if you get a disease by doing this or doing this or doing this, then why in the world preach what we preach?
Yeah, that's right.
The Lord knows how she got it. And he loved her so much that he said, if you'll believe the gospel and you'll surrender your life to me, follow me, and there is the place of your healing. God broke the power of that thing. We've seen dozens healed of hepatitis that God are from using dirty needles. He said, listen to me. God knows how you got there, what he cares about. What are you going to do with Jesus? It's time to make a decision that tonight's the night I will arise and come into the presence of my Father. He'll take me just like I am, and he'll change me. He'll change me. Would you come tonight in the name of Jesus?
There's nothing too dirty.
Come on, listen to it.
That you can't make worthy.
He'll do that for you tonight.
You wash me in mercy.
Jesus.
I am clean. There's nothing too dirty.
He's talking to you.
That you can't make worthy.
And he'll do it right now.
You wash me in mercy.
Jesus.
I am clean.
Would you come? Would you come? You need the presence of the Father.
What was dead now lives again. My heart's beating inside my chest. Coming alive with joy and destiny. 'Cause you're restoring me piece by piece. There's nothing too dirty. that you can't make worthy. You wash me in mercy. I am clean. There's nothing too dirty that you can't make worthy. Wash me in mercy. I am clean. Washed in the blood of your sacrifice. Your blood flowed red and made me white. My dirty rags are purified. I am clean. Washed in the blood of your sacrifice. Your blood flowed red and made me white. My dirty rags are purified. I'm clean. Washed in the blood of your sacrifice. Your blood flowed red and made me white. My dirty rags are purified.
Sleep is gone, my heart is full of sorrow.
If you're able, if you're not able.